Welcome everyone. Thank you for joining us for today's webinar. My name is Sayeda Kisai Zehra. I am Program Officer and Research Associate at South Asia Research Institute for Minorities.
Our organization serves as the platform for social activists and individuals from within minorities and indigenous communities to engage their creative spirit and drive innovative solutions to the challenges that minorities are facing should be taken into account.
Today we are discussing unity of oppressed minorities of South Asia. Our speakers are Dr. Gehan Gunatai Lake from Sri Lanka, Dr. Father Tapan Camilius D. Rosario from Bangladesh, Ravi Dawani from Pakistan, and Dr. Abhay Kumar from India. A warm welcome to all of you. And I want to let my participants know that you can ask questions from any speaker related to this topic by sending in private chat. Without wasting any time, I would like to invite our speaker from Sri Lanka, Dr. Gehan Gunatai Lake. He is DPhil in Law, Masters in International Human Rights Law, Visiting Fellow, Harvard Law School. We are glad to have you, sir.
A number of religious groups, including Muslims and some Christians, firmly believe that the deceased should be buried and not cremated. It is in fact widely believed that other forms of disposal of a corpse, such as cremation, are contrary to religious teachings and can even jeopardize the prospects of the afterlife of the deceased. So the freedom of religion, including the freedom to manifest religion or belief, is protected under the Sri Lankan constitution. The constitution explicitly mentions that such freedom includes worship, observance, practice, and teaching. So it is difficult to exclude the last rites of a person from the scope of this freedom, as there is certainly some form of religious observance and practice involved in the ritual of a funeral. So I think it's fair to say that this particular matter is a matter of religious freedom. If not the religious freedom of the deceased individual, at least it involves the religious freedom of the family members. That is the freedom to conduct the last rites of a loved one, a relative, according to one's religious beliefs. So with those opening remarks, I want to move on to the second question. How has this particular issue affected the Muslim community in Sri Lanka? Now, the particular policy I'm talking about came through new regulations promulgated or issued under the quarantine ordinance in Sri Lanka, which stipulates that a corpse of a person who has died or is suspected to have died of the coronavirus disease shall be cremated. So it's a mandatory cremation policy. The regulation was issued in April 2020, last year. And in my view, there is an obvious restriction taking place or being imposed on the freedom of Muslims in particular, who wish to bury instead of cremate their deceased family members who are suspected of having COVID-19. So the new regulation, I think, undoubtedly amounts to a restriction on freedom of religion. As a result of this restriction, Muslims have become particularly vulnerable to discrimination. Now, why do I say that these measures amount to discrimination? I think it's a fairly simple matter. The ordinary means of disposing the dead amongst the Buddhist majority community in Sri Lanka, as well as the Hindu community, is in fact cremation. So cremation has been recognized by the World Health Organization as being neither safer no more dangerous than burial. So in essence, the world's leading health organization, which I might add, Sri Lanka routinely follows on most health policies or health policy matters, has in fact found that burial and cremation are on par in terms of the risks involved in spreading COVID-19. So there's no real rational basis to pick one method over the other. The government appears to be privileging those who already prefer cremation and discriminating against those who prefer burial. So I think this is how discrimination sometimes works. The government can stipulate a general rule and apply to everyone. We can say that cremation is applicable to everyone, but the impact may be minimal for those who already prefer a particular form of disposing a body over another. So when the general rule mandates cremation, it will naturally privilege those who prefer cremation and discriminate against those who prefer burial. So I think this is undoubtedly an example of where a facially neutral policy is actually impacting a particular religious minority and resulting in actually the oppression of that minority, because something as important as burial is prevented due to the policy. So let me move on to the final sort of question that I want to deal with. What ought to be the appropriate response? And I think the theme of this very important webinar also touches on the question that I want to raise. First, let me make a few remarks about the appropriate state response, and then I'll move on to what I think the appropriate collective response ought to be. First of all, let me say that pitting public health, the coronavirus crisis, the pandemic, is after all a public health issue. So pitting public health against religious freedom in this instance, I think, is extremely insincere. This is not a choice between public health or religious freedom. These interests should not be seen as mutually incompatible. You can and should safeguard both public health and religious freedom simultaneously. And that's, in fact, the job of the state. I think this is a question of freedom and the justification of restrictions on freedom. So in a sense, we're all born free and free to act as we please, provided that our actions don't harm others. So I think people are inherently free to perform the last rites of their loved ones according to their religious beliefs. And any restriction on this freedom must be carefully and convincingly justified. So if a restriction is to be lawfully imposed on the freedom, a religious freedom to bury one's family members, it has to be justified based on some public interest, some objective to prevent harm. Now, it is entirely possible to place some restrictions on this right in the interest of public health. The restriction must be established as necessary to protect the interest of public health. Individuals then will have a duty to practice their religion in a manner that does not harm another's interest in public health. And we have all kinds of examples where certain religious freedoms can be restricted in the interest of public health. But this brings me to two absolutely important crucial principles. The first is the principle of proportionality. When determining what is an appropriate restriction on religious freedom, the state has to act proportionately. That means it has to pursue the least restrictive means of protecting that public interest, in this case, public health. The cost imposed on religious freedom must be outweighed by the benefits that accrue to public health. So in the present case, a total prohibition on burial, which is what is happening through the regulations that I discussed, the total prohibition on burial appears to be entirely disproportionate means of protecting public health. Instead, there could be some guidelines on how burials could be safely conducted while minimizing the risks of infection. For example, public gatherings at funeral ceremonies can be restricted to sort of mitigate the risks of individuals transmitting the virus to one another. These types of measured restrictions, I think, are permissible during a public health crisis. And many, many countries have imposed some limited restrictions on the rights of persons to conduct their last rites of their family members. Apart from the principle of proportionality, there is another principle, and that's the principle of non-discrimination. And I think this principle also has to be adhered to. As mentioned earlier, the WHO has already declared that there is no distinction between cremation and burial. So if restrictions are imposed or are to be imposed during funeral ceremonies and reasonable restrictions, they need to be imposed across the board and not with respect to only one type of ceremony. If you're having restrictions in terms of, say, the number of people that can attend a funeral, it has to be equally applicable to both funerals involving cremation and funerals involving burial. Instead, what we have in Sri Lanka is a total prohibition on burials. So the total prohibition on burials without any scientific evidence to back it, I think is both disproportionate and discriminatory. So it violates both these principles that I mentioned. Let me end with one last reflection. What should the collective response be to this issue? What should advocates of minority rights, not just in Sri Lanka, but across South Asia, really do in response to this issue? I think the Muslim community in Sri Lanka has responded to the ban with a great deal of restraint and maturity. The protests against the ban have been peaceful, despite the enormous anguish that the policy has caused. And I think that kind of maturity must be received and met with equal maturity on the part of the government. And in fact, the Prime Minister very recently announced in Parliament that the policy would be reversed. And I think that was the proper mature response. But unfortunately, his party very quickly backpedaled and said that they're not interested in reversing the policy until their so-called expert committee changes its opinion. So in fact, there was an expert committee appointed by the government previously that published a report stating that there is no difference in the public health risk between burial and cremation. So the government has had plenty of opportunities to change its policy while saving face, and instead it has continued to enforce its policy. So I think actors both within and outside Sri Lanka, including in the South Asian region, should engage this issue and keep pressing the government of Sri Lanka to do the right thing. And I think it needs as much pressure and encouragement to foster tolerance and coexistence in Sri Lankan society, which I think has for far too long featured the oppression of minorities. I'm going to pause there and I look forward to the discussion to follow.
Thank you for dedicating your time and sharing your views. Thank you so much. Moving to the next speaker, Dr. Father Tepan Camillus de Rosario, head of the Department of World Religion and Culture, University of Dhaka. Thank you, sir, for making time for us. We are glad to have you.
Okay. A very good evening to you all for organizing this special contemporary relevant issue. Though we are living in different countries in the CERT areas of Southeast Asia, but we are facing almost the same problem. So this forum, I think, is an occasion for each and everyone to identify our problems, share it, and to make greater awareness for the civilians as well as to raise voice if government needs to be heard. So while I was asked to participate here, I was thinking that what should I tell about it? Because daily newspapers or mass media or communication journalism, what they bring us? They bring issues that are really nowadays great problems, and amidst this COVID-19, perhaps many of our problems are not heard by each other. And these are the forum. The webinar is also an access to come closer to each other. Actually, if you know the real situation now in Bangladesh regarding the refugee problem, the great community people migrated from Myanmar to Bangladesh, the Rohingyas. So that is a great political issue as well as social concern. Though the country welcomed them, gave shelter, hospitality, and now also with international help, giving them all the basic human needs, but the main question remains unanswered yet. Why not did to go back to their home country? So that discussion politically and locally, interregion way, I should say, is not yet fruitful. So how long people can stay as refugee? It should be a concern for each and everyone, and also United Nations involved here. But with the change of Myanmar's government, it has gone back to the military regime again. So the whole limelight goes in a darker position. So that is humanitarian aspect, but also a minority aspect, because they are the minority there and they are almost bound to leave the country and take shelter here. So as a neighbor, the country has done it, but it is a concern for each and everyone. And inside the country, definitely in Bangladesh, there are some ethnic groups, linguistically minority, religious way minority, and especially the indigenous people, they're also minorities. When we had freedom in 1971, the whole nation fought for liberation. They were united with a great motto that this democratic country will help to enjoy all the citizens, despising religion or color, will enjoy the equal rights and dignity. But slowly, regime after regime, the government after government came, and some of them they changed one of the main pillars of our original constitution. They abolished the term secularism and they imposed Islamic Republic of Bangladesh, this type of phrase there. So there are some discussion, some question, but so far nobody is going to change that. What happens then? Actually, that makes that due to faith-based community, you don't enjoy something what should you have enjoyed equally with others. So this type of sentiment, it is not good for a country, a people, because for the betterment, for the building up of this country, all are unitedly working together. So that is one of the issue that minority, they feel that it should not be there. And from the liberation time onward, if we see the minority groups migrated to other countries, how many? If you take year by year statistics, certainly that is alarming. The percentage of Hindus, what they had, is almost very less now. So this, what does indicate? Do they leave the country for their better life or a secure life? And what happens, how situation is deteriorated? Very often recently we see somebody will take advantage of the Facebook. He will somehow steal the Facebook ID of a minority, and then he will download some objectionable pictures, and then it will be circulated, and then demonstration, viral situation, then a lot of happening here and there. So this type of situation, actually, so far so after happening, nobody is caught and nobody is just and nobody is punished. So that is the sad thing, because there must be somebody, some mastermind who are doing it. They must be punished according to the existing law. But when it is not done, we feel very much sorry that what is happening here. Yes, from the government, from the top level, they are very proactive. That's true. But when my church, my faithful's house, or Christian community, or Hindu or Buddhist temples or pagodas are destroyed, so that time what to do? Maybe government will come and rebuild the houses or the temples. But what about the mind and heart of the people? Is it rebuildable? So this kind of story all across the Indian subcontinent that has given a lot of problem in the social community here and there. And once the minority here, he may be minority here, but in a greater global way, he's majority in other country. So by doing so, maybe we are inviting them, what we are doing here as majority, you also can do it there, but it should not be the modern day neighborhood or fellow man's attitude at all. Because one sorrow, one success that touches each and everyone nowadays. So therefore, I should say that the government system, judgment, and all this system must very much active in this way so that nobody feels that he's minority here. Because this majoritarianism, and also there is minoritarianism. So this is not good at all. Sometimes minority also feel that we are minority, what can we do? So this kind of mentality we need to overcome. But we can overcome when the majority acts as a elder brother. So if the brother is okay, then the other brothers are also okay in the family. So this type of situation here, also there are some minority groups like the Urdu speaking Biharis after liberation who were here. What is their situation? So are they stateless or do they have a state? Or indigenous people, every now and then we hear how their land and property being grabbed by the powerful people. So this type of incident full of statistics, but we want to raise awareness that human dignity, respect must be there, and law enforcement legislation must be in day-to-day life applied for each and every citizen. So the common pattern what we have, there's something happening in a central way, and then we are ignorant or silent. That should not be the way. So religious minority, ethnicity, language factors, all these are minority issues. So the government as well as civilians, we need to be aware of that, especially this type of forum. We do have a lot of organizations. Some are involved with regionally, or some are with United Nations. So they must have some protocol. But do we follow all this? Are they applicable or just bypassed? So this is the situation nowadays, that we must do something for the majority, or even religious Dalits, or even among the Muslims. What about the Ahmadiyyas? They're also sometimes persecuted or deprived of their religious practice or the right or anything. So my realization today here is that the rising of majority sentiment must be addressed so that government, the law enforcement agency, and the civilians, the triad, work hand in hand. There are law, but if we don't apply those laws when something happening negative and very bad, so that gives occasion for others. And sometimes what we say, justice delayed, justice denied. So this type of situation is prevailing all over the countries. So we should say that in this time, we need to come closer to each other. In Afghanistan, the problem what they have in Pakistan, in India, in Sri Lanka, there are a lot of similarities. So maybe we can work together and this kind of minority forums, working with the rights and dignity and bringing the news to the greater forum will help. And I appreciate and try to do everything in favor of human dignity, respect, our religious freedom, and there should not be discrimination due to religions. Humanity came first, religion came later. So we must respect the human freedom, human dignity by at any cost. Maybe this much I can share now. If you have any question later on, maybe I'll be able to add more. I was having some problem to join in the webinar due to Wi-Fi slow connections, but any I could join meeting all of you. Thank you each and everyone. Gehan already spoke very well, and Dr. Saeed waiting. Abhay is also waiting, Ravi, and then Mahesh and others. Not only joined here, but whoever here. Usually for this type of work, we don't find thousands of people, but it's like the small candle that we lit, and that is lit against the darkness that brings fear, that brings our problem in society, in state, in the region, in the world. Thank you so much.
I really appreciate your words, sir. Thank you so much. Anybody wants to ask anything related to the topic, please message us privately. Move to our next speaker, Ravi Diwani, Secretary General, All Pakistan Hindu Panchayat. Thank you, sir, for making out the time for this webinar. Over to you.
Okay. Thanks, Saram. You have to give us opportunity to being a part of this international conference. At the moment, I think so. This should be addressed because this is the time when we have to be everyone think about the corona and the different activities are going on, and the people can be lived alone at their own houses, and they have spent in their houses lonely, that they can think about that where we are going, what will be the opportunities for us, and what will basically the things are the humanitarian. If you are being a good human, then I think so this will be above from the angels and everything is above. So now I am coming from the basically in Pakistani. In a Pakistan, basically as you see that then in 1947, we has been be separated from the two countries has been be developed. And after 1971, we can divide it in two, that Bangladesh and Pakistan. So if we can see that in Bangladesh, approximately 22% Hindus lived at there in 1947. And in Pakistan, they have approximately 15% Hindus lived in the Pakistan. So total 37% of the population lived in the Indo-Bangladesh and that. After the migration, approximately 4.7 million people, Hindus can be migrated from the only from the Pakistan. This is a very big, big mess, huge migration, and approximately 1 million people has been killed in that separation. So, on behalf of that one, because when we have a same color, same language, same thing, so we have to be divided in three part of the life, and for just for the nothing, if when more than 100 years, the Mughals and other can be king, being a king of our total country, Indo-Pak. So we can be lived safely and we can live very calm and quiet. Then I think so we must think about this one, that we can lose our lovers and lose our very nearer in this 1 million peoples. And I think so millions and million peoples have suffered, and they can lived in the refugee camps, and they can be even today, till today, they, if they can live, the tears come their eyes. So this is the basically, and the second migration in Pakistan, that should be in Afghan war. If you can go back through in Afghan war, 82, I think so, that there's approximately 2.5 million people has been migrated from Afghanistan. This will be the second migration, which can be Pakistan. But basically third migration. The first point of view in 1947, second will be in 1971 in the Bangladesh one. The Bangladeshi, so many peoples came here. And in the third one, Afghan war, so that will be covered. So coming on that point, that the what we have achieved on these three migrations, in spite we have losing our lovers, our nearer, our there is a very big blood shedding is there. For what? At the moment, if you can think about the Qaedism never want an Islamic country. Qaedism, even the speech of that one, 11th August, they want the minorities will be safe and secure. And in Pakistan, you are free to go in your temple, you can free to go your prayer. So the basic thing is that, and even if you can go through in the first, even law minister was our Hindu community, belonged to Hindu community. So the basic thing is that, so slowly, gradually, we are coming in this situation. Now our minorities are going to be transferred. Hindu communities are again moving there. They have been slowly and gradually there. The conversions are there. The young girls has been forcefully converted. So, and slowly and gradually the temple has been attacked. But that should be not only for the Hindus, but even for the majority. If you can see the Muslims, mosques are there. They have also their issues there. They have also issues with them also. So even, and if you can see the few months back in Quetta, there's a lot of big community has been attacked, and 11 or 12 people has been died on that one. So we want peace, because basically every part of the world, they want to the interfaith harmony. They want to the unite. They want to the one solution. They want to go for one hand-to-hand. They can sit with the hand-to-hand to resolve their issues. And I think, so if you can go through their issues, I think so there's nothing should be there. Just peanut issues can be highlighted. Just the peanut issues can be transferred. So that should be still, we have to be addressed that one. In that one, I will request our ulmas, I request with the pandits, I request with our padaris, so they can come forward and they can give a proper streamline. They can streamline our people So they can be, I think so, when Molvi will come to the reach in the mosque, when Pandit will go to the temple, when Padri will go to the church, so the people will listen them. When people will listen them, so whatever you want to make the guideline, so they can follow that one. So I think so, this is the time when we have come forward. We request our religious people, they will come forward. They can sit together and they can sort out these things, you know. Because I think so, this is the, at the moment, even in European countries, if you can go through, then for the school, Somali school boy, they have been killed in the France, in France. So everywhere, you can see there a very short temper, where everyone has an angriness comes in their brain. Everyone is a feel, just want to fight with each other. There is no any tolerance are there. There is no any sympathy with each other. So the basic thing is that at the moment, we need some sympathy with each other. We must respect the religions. We must respect our each other. So I think so. If you can respect with each other, so this is the, I think so. This will be the main prayer. This will be the main message for the everyone, for all over the world, who are the representing in their own countries. They can work for their peace. They work for the interfaith harmony. They work for the lover ones. So we can make this world a beautiful flower, beautiful garden in which the different flowers will be blown up and there will be, with smell is very good. Otherwise, if you can put a single type of flower, just like a rose, that should be not attracted by people. But if you can put different type of flowers, so that will be very attractive and very colorful, and everyone should be attractive. And being a Hindu community, if you can see, there are all customs also depending upon the weathers and the culture, just like Holi. So Holi will be different colors, you know. So we can, and every our in a festival, when you can see there the message was there. Either you can go for the Diwali. The Diwali is the spreading the message when the devil has been be defeated. And the winning of the good one to the evil one. So even the same one, Ramchandra came from the to defeat the Ravan. So he came to there, and the people will be celebrated, and is lit of the lamps. So this is the, everyone will be happy. So even a Holi, you can also sing that the same message was there. So we have a very rich culture. In Indo-Pak, when you can go through it, we have a very rich culture. We have a Mohenjo-daro, approximately 5,000 years. There's a very rich culture, Mohenjo-daro, you can see is there. So what we have? We have to be protected there. We have to be, even you can go to the Europe, when we spend a million of rupees to see for the Simal for nothing. But if you can come to the Pakistan, I will give you the one temple example of. There is one temple in Clifton. This is called Shiv temple. This is approximately 200 feet down from the earth, 7 steps down from the earth. And that will be, the upper side is a solid stone and the lower side is a limestone. All over the world, you can't see this one, this type of temple 200 feet down. And the upper side is a hard stone and the lower side is lime. This is also a miracle. How the even a fresh water is coming is there. So even you can go to the Karachi, there is a one temple. They have the where they can, you can find the first light of the sun. So we have a what rich culture. We have a in Astana very big Shiv temple, Shiv Lunga. All over the world, there the second Shiv Lunga is there in Mansehra. Even the Katas Raj. You have to find the Shiv, the tears of Shiv. So we have a, what in spite of we can fighting with each other, we have to be protect. We can protect the people. We can guide to the people to come forward. In spite we are giving the people, so we can spend our million of rupees. For what? We have to be come forward. Bangladeshi is our brothers. Even everyone is our brother. So we have a, no need of fighting with each other. this is the time when we the world, because in a corona things, you can't, nobody knows where the corona will be affected, how the corona will person will be affected within 3 days gone. So you can't, the billion of rupees, you can't get the advantage of that billion of rupees, but within 3 days you can leave your life. Nothing should be left. So it means there's the nothing, the money will be nothing. Money will be not for the all thing for everyone. Money is the every, the small importance, there's no problem. But the very important thing is the interfaith harmony. We have to be work together. We request our religious people to come forward, and we can, and even I also put one point that whatever the people has been migrated, whatever the people came under the refugees, we have to be definitely put some streamline that on from which year they will be allowed, or in which city they can be allowed, and how we can manage it, and what the facilities we can give to them after many, how many years. When you allow any refugee or when you allow any person in your own country, so it means now he is your part of your life. This is all the families will be on your shoulders. So you have to be safe, you have to be protect, you have to be give them all rules and regulations and everything, health benefit, what benefit, whatever the policy will be made. Definitely when you can allow them, either if you can't give the health facilities, either you can't give them anything, then you can't give the permission. It's a better, you can't allow to them. This is my question. And at the end, I will last my prayer to my every Indo-Pak people that please come forward, join our hands. And this is the time we can use the interfaith harmony. There are a lot of NGOs are working out there. And this is the time, being a All Pakistan Hindu Panchayat, I can welcome to every person. They can come to along. I'm in Karachi. So you can come along here. So we can, whatever facilities you want, we can welcome to everyone. Thank you.
I appreciate your effort, thought and view, sir. Thank you so much. And now I would like to call a speaker from India, Dr. Abhay Kumar, to further discussion. He is a writer, journalist and social activist. Thank you for joining us, sir. I would like to know your thought regarding this topic. Over to you, sir.
South Asian Research Institute for Minorities, for giving me this opportunity. And thank you also, Zahra Naqvi, for sending me this email. Today's discussion is very important. I have paid attention to the speech of all the speakers. For example, our friend from Sri Lanka is talking about Dr. Gehema Guna Tilke, that how the corona pandemic was used by the Sri Lankan government to further suppress the religious freedom of the minorities community. Similarly, Dr. Father Tapar from Bangladesh, he also stressed the importance of harmony. And Ravi Dawani from Pakistan, he also said that harmony is very important thing. As a student of history, I want to read out a few quotations from freedom fighters, from the makers of India and Pakistan. And when we read their speeches, we find that they never stood for a nation that is based on theology, that is based on religion. But unfortunately, politics and also self-interest took a very nasty turn, and the subcontinent was divided into two countries. What Rabi Dawani Sahab was talking about, the three huge migrations. So let me first start with Sir Syed Ahmad Khan. I think many historians in Pakistan think that he was the founder of Pakistani movement, but he said once that Sir Syed Ahmad Khan, the founder of Aligarh Muslim University, that I have always said that our country, our land of India, is like a newly wedded bride whose two beautiful eyes are Hindus and Muslims. That both Hindus and Muslims are like beautiful eyes, two eyes of a bride. This was his views. Gandhi also echoed Sir Syed Ahmad's words later in 1920, and he said that Hindus and Muslims are like two eyes of the same country. There should be no enmity between them. This is Gandhi. Maulana Azad, as a president of Indian National Congress in 1940s, when the relations between the Congress and the Muslim Leagues deteriorated and soured, he said that everything bears the stamp of our joint endeavor. Our languages were different, but we grew to use a common language. Our manners and customs were different, but they produced a new synthesis. No fantasy of artificial scheming to separate and divide can break this unity. Islam has now as great a claim on the Indian soil as Hinduism has. So you could see that from Sir Syed Ahmad Khan, Mahatma Gandhi, and even Maulana Azad, they were all talking about Hindu-Muslims unity. And also Qaid-e-Azam, whose speech Rabi Dawani Sahab was mentioning on August 11, 1947, when Muhammad Ali Jinnah said that now I think we should keep that in front of us as our ideal. And you will find that in course of time, Hindus would cease to be Hindus, and Muslims would cease to be Muslims, not in the religious sense, because that is the personal faith of each individual, but in the political sense as citizens of state. So in India, our gods are Gandhi, our gods are Maulana Azad and Nehru. And here in Pakistan, Qaid-e-Azam is considered the father of the nation. If you read their speeches, you will find that they were not sectarian, they were not communal, but self-interest. Inability of the leaders to share power with people from the different communities led to partition, led to division of the country. And then we have great tragedy, I think. No writer can express it. The tragedy, millions of people were killed, butchered, they were raped, they were injured, they were driven out of their home. So, The point which I want to stress is that minority problem is not a very small thing. I think the history of subcontinent is the history of injustice done to minorities. And it is not only Pakistan and India where minorities are mistreated. Even in Bangladesh and Sri Lanka, we our friends and our distinguished speakers have already pointed out. And particularly in Sri Lanka, the way the rebels were treated and the way a state used violence against them, I think it has got no, I think, parallel. Very few parallel you will find it. And in India, I should not be sympathetic with our own leaders and our old politicians who presided over and who were at the helm of the affairs when the riots took place. I think after 1947, for a few years, the riots could not take place. But after 1960s, the vicious cycle of riots have never happened and never stopped. And most of the people who suffered were unfortunately Muslims. I think they were killed. And sometimes many social scientists have said that we should not call those conflicts as riots, because they were very much sponsored and promoted by the state, and the state police and machinery, they were all acting against Muslims community. Now, this is the background. And as a student of history and also politics, I believe that human society can only live when we are ready to share power with them, when we realize that there are multiple truths, when we do not create a majority on the basis of religion or on the basis of community. I think in a democracy, people should elect the government, people should have a right to reject them, but there cannot be Hindu majority or Muslim majority or Buddhist majority. But it is very unfortunately that in subcontinent, the attacks against minority continue. And it is very sad that in Indian media, in journalists working in Indian media, they are all the time looking for how minorities are attacked in Pakistan, in Bangladesh, and they will make big news out of that. On the other hand, when minorities are killed, when minorities are discriminated, not far away from their own newsroom, they will not talk about that. So this is the irony. And what should I say? I think now the world is much more connected. You know what is happening in India. And the last 6 and 7 years has been very difficult time for people believing in democracy, people believing in minority rights and justice. You know that a right-wing government has come to power in India, and its agenda is to impose some majoritarian Hindu culture. And they talk about majoritarian Hindu culture, but if you try to look at more closely, I think they are talking about the interest of a few upper caste, few Brahmin caste. So they are talking about Hindu majority, but it is nothing but re-impositions of what should I say, the upper caste rule or the Brahminical rule, that we must oppose it. And even the great Baba Saheb Ambedkar has also said that nothing could be so bad than the imposition of Hindu rule in this country. So people in India, they are fighting it. I think democracy is all about a struggle. Democracy is all about resistance. I think nothing is given to us on plate, and the rights are always snatched through fight and through struggle. So people are fighting here. People are fighting here, both Hindus and Muslims, minorities, women and men, Christians, Dalits, Adivasis, they are all united. And now you might be aware of the fact that in Delhi for last 2 months, thousands and lakhs of people are sitting here. They are farmers and they are opposing 3 draconian laws, I should say, 3 laws which gives the laws which were passed by Indian Parliament, and they are now paving the way for the big corporate giant to come and to buy grains from the farmers as much as they can, and they can hoard it. And you know that the prices of grains and vegetables, they fluctuate because the farmers do not have proper facility to store them. So now the crony capitalism has come in, and the farmers are protesting, and 200 I think people have died due to cold and other issues. But the government has not paid any attention. And on the 26th of January, the Republic Day in India, they were badly beaten up. Now, as far as Muslims is concerned, it is very difficult time. And my friend from Sri Lanka, Dr. Gehan Gunatilke, has just said that how the corona issue was used against the minority community in India also. The situation was very bad. What has happened? That our government suddenly announced the lockdown, the nationwide lockdown, and the people were not given sufficient time, no arrangement was made, and there was no planning on the side of the government. And when huge number of people, particularly the migrant laborers, when they started starving, they had no money, water, and also place to live, and when they came out to the street, and it was the situations when the government thought that now they will not be able to control it. At that time, the disease of corona has been communalized. It was given a tag, a new name. The Muslim name was given to corona. And one story was planted with the help of the media, the plant media, that a particular Muslim religious group, they have gathered in Delhi illegally, and they are responsible for the spread of corona virus and corona disease. And suddenly, all focus of media and people from the failure of the government has been shifted to the failure of the minority communities to live as a responsible citizen. And then our media just started writing very nasty thing about the minorities and Muslims were made victims. And unfortunately, Muslim vegetable sellers, they were not allowed to enter in several localities, and special figures for the for those being infected with the corona disease were given, and it was given a Muslim tag. For example, there was one general count that how many people are have been corona positive, and there was another table to tell that how many Muslims and Tablighi have been infected with corona disease. So it was a time when the failure of the government was very much there, but then it was given a communal color. It was given a religious color. But fortunately, that after a few months, even the Honorable High Court had said that the Muslims were made the scapegoats during the corona period, and they were called, they were blamed for spreading corona virus, and it was the judgment of the Bombay High Court. So one issue is corona, of course, and then the second is the temple issue. You know that a temple is being rebuilt there, and unfortunately, it is not only the organization or trust which is behind the construction of the temple. It is the government machinery which is there to build that temple. It is very unfortunate that in a secular democracy, our prime minister, amid what should I say, corona pandemic, he went to Ayodhya, the site of the Ram temple, and he did puja there without having any care and regards for any corona guidelines. And now reports in media are appearing and they are coming that minorities are being threatened in several areas, and they are asked to give chanda donations for the constructions of the Ram temple. So so the question is not only just minority, even Dalits, the ex-untouchables, they are also being suppressed. Lower caste people are also suppressed, and welfare measures are being attacked by this neoliberal government. So my conclusion would be that it is not only the questions of majority and minority. The government in South Asia, they are basically serving the interest of the big capital. They are serving the interest of the big classes. And to hide their failures, they try to demonize, they try to other the Muslims community. That is why the fight is here, as South Asian Research Institute for Minority has rightly pointed out, that the fight is to have a unity between the oppressed minorities. And when we talk about oppressed minority, we have to keep in mind that the question of gender, the question of caste, and the question of class, they should not be forgotten. For example, if I am a Hindu in Pakistan, I cannot just talk about Hindu as if that is a monolithic community. There are Dalits, there are lower caste communities with whom I think upper caste people have very little day-to-day interactions, and I think intermarriage and interdining is not happening. Similarly, in Pakistan, the upper caste Muslims and the lower caste Muslims have little interactions. So the questions of caste, the questions of gender, the questions of class, they are also very, very important. We cannot just blame government. We cannot just ask government to act democratically, to act in a way that will promote democracy, promote egalitarian. On the other hand, we as a leader of community, we will not be open to people from our own community who are sitting at the lower strata. So a few months back, when I had one interactions with another webinar with the friends of Pakistan, many friends from Karachi said that in Pakistan also the lower caste people have got little access to powerful people. So I'm not blaming the Hindu communities there. I know they are suffering, Similarly, the Muslims communities are also suffering in India also. But as a minority, our claim for justice, our claim for equality can only get strengthened and can get more and more support when we are also open to internal critique. For example, caste, class, gender, these are very, very important issues. We cannot treat Shia as if they are not a complete Muslim. We cannot say that Ahmadiyyas are not complete Muslim. Their faith, their rituals may differ with them, but they are all citizens of this country, and constitution gives them equal opportunity, equal rights. That is why we should not discriminate them. With these words, I thank once again South Asian Research Institute for Minorities for inviting me. I think I have just expressed my my thoughts and my feelings. It was not very much well organized and articulated. If there are some points which have not been incorporated, or if there is any clarifications or doubt or misunderstanding, I will be open to your questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. I appreciate the information and advice you share into this sensitive matter. We really need it. Thank you a lot. We will go ahead to take some questions for now. Mavish, please, you ask the questions.
On the behalf of participants, I would like to ask few questions from the speakers. First question goes for the Dr. Gehan. Okay, do you think can authorities stop the spread of extremist rhetoric through the majority religious group in Sri Lanka?
Well, I mean, I think one particular government is not going to be in a position to end prejudice. I think the prejudice that exists in society is deeper and more entrenched than the policies of a particular government. Governments have been opportunistic in wielding and exacerbating and sort of really utilizing this prejudice that exists. And instead of trying to build coexistence, I think governments and governments in the past, and the present government included, has tended to be opportunistic in the way they actually apply this type of prejudice. But I think the real answer to changing majoritarian attitudes in Sri Lanka is cultural transformation. And cultural transformation is a long-term project. It's going to take a lot of hard work. It's going to take almost a generation of really difficult work in reversing certain majoritarian attitudes in Sri Lanka. It includes things like revising the history curricula. It includes things like really looking at the education system and looking at how the constitution privileges certain communities and not other communities. So there's a lot of work to be done. And I don't think a particular government, just by changing policies, can do so. But having said that, the current policy in Sri Lanka on cremations, I think, is opportunistic in the way it appeases majoritarian sentiment, and it does a lot more harm than good. And I think these policies have to be reversed to at least start the process of that cultural transformation that I spoke of. Unfortunately, I have another engagement and I'm going to have to run off, but I want to thank once again the conveners and the speakers for a wonderful discussion. And I thank the organizers for inviting me.
Thank you so much, Doctor. Second question is for the Doctor, Father Tappan Karinas. According to the South Asia State of Minority Report 2019, published by the European Union and the Norwegian Agency for Development Cooperation, in this report, the Urdu-speaking Bangladeshis, Dalits, and Rohingyas are the most persecuted. So what steps should government take for the effective implementation of the elimination of all form of racial discrimination?
Actually, I told that there are a few minority groups in Bangladesh of Buddhist, Hindus, Christians. So they are religiously minority. And language-wise, if you see, then the indigenous people, they are the minorities. And what you brought the question of, that is the Urdu-speaking community, that means the Biharis, after liberation who remained here, but due to political problems, so they were supposed to go back to Pakistan, but actually we know that both the countries, they could not come to a good decision and take them back. So this is not a government of Bangladesh that intentionally persecuting them, but the situation usually in a community when others, they see them as betrayer or collaborator or anti-liberation, so supposedly it gives them little problem. Where I live last couple of years, the Geneva camp or other Bihar camps are nearby, and some of them, they were working with us. I had frequented them, but it is not so bad as we hear. I should say so. Yes, living condition is not very hygienic, but when it happens, if you stay in a camp or in a refugee a shelter, usually a hygienic situation, air, water, everything is in scarcity, and in a very minimum access is there. So that they're having, and they're doing very small jobs, maybe in the office sector, they cannot go, and also for education, they cannot come forward because they don't have any school, college of their own. They have to come out of their camp and be admitted in the neighboring schools and others, but they prefer to earn money. So far, so I experienced. And when a kid or a small boy earning money, he loses his all the interest of going to the school. They're thinking, oh, that man, after education, getting certificates, the amount of money he's getting, or he's remaining jobless. But if I have my own handwork, I know I can earn sufficient amount of money. And another problem I have seen that many of them, they are some kind of addiction is there. So it happens, some NGOs, some voluntary people, they're working there. But the major question remains that whether they will be really integrated in the bigger community in Bangladesh, or they'll go back to their relatives living in Pakistan. I think the government, the NGOs and United Nations, they're working on it, but they must boost up and come to a solution so that their situation also gets a lot of importance and improved according to the standard of modern day. So I wish that this kind of a small voice, that togetherly it will be a big voice, and it will be heard by the proper person, and a problem must be solved with discussion and decision. I don't know whether I could explain myself, but that much I could say regarding the language-based minority group of the Urdu community here in Dhaka or in some cities in the western side of Bangladesh, maybe in Saipur or some in Chittagong. So scatteredly, they are here.
Thank you so much, Father, for your answer. Okay, third question is for the Dr. Abhay Kumar. How the India government can provide the technical assistance and training to the Indian authority toward the creating an inclusive minorities communities and a non-discriminatory citizenship regimes?
See, government cannot give some technical training. It's not the question of giving technical training and educating people or maybe running some courses. What has happened that the government currently in power, they are not working for the benefit of the people. The policies are not much geared towards the welfare of people. It is working more for upper classes, upper caste people, for the big corporate. So there will be anger. To divert that anger, they have to create an enemy. They have to create some fictitious danger. And in India, election happens all the time. It's not authoritarian regime that you hold elections once or you may not hold it. So election in states assemblies or maybe in general assembly, the cycle of elections keeps rolling all the time. So government has to mobilize people. It has to get support out of them. So what is it doing? The government is polarizing voters on the basis of religion. And it is going and telling voters that, okay, you belong to this community, you belong to this religious group. We are the real well-wisher of that particular religion, that majority religion. So you vote for us. I should vote for you. I should vote for the government on the basis of the policies. But government is trying to believe us that we are promoting the cause of Hindus. And those who do not agree with them, they are not true Hindu. That is very unfortunate agenda in any democracy. If I disagree with you, I do not become less Muslim. Suppose if I'm in Pakistan and if I disagree with the current regime, I am not less Muslim than those who are in power. So basically, the government is trying to achieve communal majority. The government is trying to achieve communal majority. And I want to stress this point. This is not true of India. This is true of almost all the countries of South Asia. Maybe the degree may vary. For example, when Corona lockdown was there, our Prime Minister, Indian Prime Minister, was talking about lighting the lamp and then beating the thali. So he was basically trying to inculcate, trying to borrow symbols from majority Hindu community. In Pakistan, Imran Sahab was borrowing symbols from, let's say, Islamic tradition. So basically, maybe I'm not equating India with Pakistan and Pakistan with India. I don't know how far our government is aggressive or how far is your government is aggressive. But worldwide, there is a rise of right-wing agenda. The right-wing agenda in Europe, you will find too much Islamophobia. You will find that in America, a black is being attacked, that George Floyd. In our country, in India, you will find that Muslims and Dalits are being attacked. In Bangladesh, you will find that some other minorities are being attacked. In Sri Lanka, the Tamilians are being attacked. So the issue is that the government is not yielding result. Government has failed miserably because the economic agenda is not for the common people. On the other hand, in politics, they can only form the government by taking majority of the votes. So this is the contradictions. So the way forward is, which I believe that it is very good that we talk about Hindu and Muslim and Christian unity, but at the same time, we should never believe that Hindu community is monolithic or Islamic community is monolithic or Christian community is monolithic. If I am upper caste, I have to be open to the criticism coming from the Dalit community. I cannot say that you are wrong. I cannot say, I have to accept that many things which are written in, let's say, scriptures, Dalits have deep problem. So what is the way out? So we have to be critical. We have to be critical. We have to open to all kinds of the criticism. Then only we can defeat it. You know, why Muslims community, why communists, why left, why the secular parties in India are not able to give a big challenge to government? Because they are internally divided. They are not hitting the real issue. So the point is, again, the same thing I'm saying again and again, that Hindu-Muslims bhai bhai is a very good idea. Hindustan, Pakistan, Bangladesh, bhai bhai is a very good idea. But wherever we are living, we have to be open to, we have to be sensitive to the minority from our own community. For example, in India, Christians among the Christians community, Father, I want to draw your attention to this fact in India. The Christians community is also divided on the basis of caste. The Christian community is also divided on the basis of sect. So you can say, you can blame the majoritarian Hindu community. You are most welcome. But why some Dalits, Christians are not welcome in church? Why all the big, posts are being held by a few people? So we have to democratize our religious institution. We have to democratize our institutional, educational institution. We have to allow our women to go. And religion is a matter of personal faith. We cannot use religion to spread communal passion, to serve the interests of the government, to pit one community against another community. In India, we will, so for example, I will use Hinduism to unite all Hindus against Muslims, against Pakistan. That will not do. In a similar way, you living in Pakistan, you should be critical of those people who are using religious symbols from the Islam to paint India as enemy. India is not enemy of Pakistan. Pakistan is not enemy of India. Few politicians are trying to perpetuate their interest by putting India against Pakistan or Pakistan against India. I love to come to Pakistan, but I don't know, the borders are closed. And most of the time, I listen to the song of a border film by Javed Akhtar. The birds have no boundary, but we human beings have created boundary. So we have to go out from nationalistic, jingoistic and nationalistic framework, and we have to be more critical about our internal problem. Dr. Ambedkar, I want to stop by saying Dr. Ambedkar gave a lecture in 1940s. The lecture is called Gandhi, Rana Day and Jinnah. And in his lecture, he said that he doesn't support Gandhi, he doesn't support Jinnah, but he has supported the ideas of Rana Day. What does it he mean, Baba Samambed? He said Gandhiji and Qaid-e Azam, they did not take up the issue of social inequality, but Rana Day from Maharashtra, he took up the issue of social inequality. So the job is to take up social inequality also. It is very easy to get support by pointing Pakistan as our enemy, or by for Pakistani people, Pakistani friends to say India is enemy. But to talk about how we are internally fighting, how mosques are divided, how temples have closed doors on their the Dalit community, how intermarriage or intercaste is not happening, how women have little access to educations, how women have little access to health and other issues. These issues are very important to achieve the issue of minority. And minority doesn't mean just only religious minority. In Constituent Assembly, in United India, minorities, the term minority includes Dalits, ex-untouchables, Christians, Adivasis, tribals, and also Muslims. So the minorities need to be defined in much more wider perspective, and the issue of economy should never be detached from the minority questions. Hindu-Muslims questions cannot be solved. India-Pakistan questions cannot be solved. I think Shia and Sunni problem cannot be solved when we do not have good economic policy for the welfare of people. If economic policy is made to help very few people, if economic policy is made to promote crony capital, then Hindu and Muslim, Christian will fight, because there is a vested interest to keep them fighting. I know I'm very sad that in Pakistan, most of scavengers, those who do safai, they come from the Christian community. In India, most of safai karamcharis, they come from the Dalit community. So we have to be open to critical of our own problem in our society. Thank you very much.
Thank you for such an informative answer. Now I move further and invite Dr. Khurram Mehdi, the director of SAREM, to conclude this session. Sir, please.
On the behalf of SAREM and on my own behalf, I am very indebted to the panel, Dr. Gihar, Dr. Father Tappan, Mr. Ravi Dawani, and Dr. Abhay Kumar for sharing with us the brilliant knowledge and the intellectual understanding of the problem. I expect the same degree of participation in this forum in the long run to foster the harmonious coexistence between the faiths and to work for the improvement of the region's marginalized part. Nowadays, when the world is coping with the variants of coronavirus, in our region, minorities have been exploited with dynamics and dimensions. The extensive rise in the minorities' persecution not only relates to one community, but it has severely impacted all communities, including Christians, Muslims, Dalits, and Sikhs. It is the need of the time that the intellectual, academics, analysts, and social activists from the regional minority community should be on the same page. The initiative for legislative safeguards and collaborative minority rights should be developed with the responsive abilities. And due to the non-availability of the demographic mapping, the persecution of innocent minorities goes unheard in the South Asian region. Here I request the post-webinar suggestion from all of the speakers pertaining to the development of a mechanism for the demographic mapping of minorities in South Asia. You may please send the same as per your convenience to my email ID so we could move to the next level, as the mapping of minorities is critically important for the unification. Thank you very much. God bless you all.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, our valuable speaker, for gracing your important work and sharing with your findings and opinion today. It was a great pleasure to have you all. Until next time, good luck and good night.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.